together. We want to be overcome by your presence, O God, in this place and on those who are watching us via the internet. We want to be overcome by the supernatural Holy Spirit in this place. We ask, Lord, we invite into our lives and therefore via us as the conduit into this room, the presence of God. We invite in Jesus' name, and we pray in that name. Amen and amen, and welcome as you are seated to this next 7-day period, today and tomorrow here in this chapel, and Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday in this chapel. We celebrate a thing we call, it is in our history for many decades, 7 days ablaze, a time where, thank you, where we run concurrently with the practitioners of the Old Testament Jewish teaching about the days of awe from last night's Feast of Tabernacles, or Rosh Hashanah, we called it, celebration, to the Yom Kippur, the holiest day of covering, where the priest worked to become would intercede for people who had adequately repented. And so we have captured that biblical foundation and say it's time for us to be in awe of who God is and ask him to work in us afresh as we repent of our sins and become more aware of who he is in us and what he wants to do in us. 7 days ablaze is our name for that idea. And you have prayer requests that have been given to each one entering this room, several that we want to pray for. These are people who watch the 700 Club. And they say, there's something happening when you guys pray. I want you to get my prayer request before God while you're doing that. But I want you to look at me for just a moment. Put the prayer request down in this room, would you please? Because there is a 4-letter word I want to use in our prayer time. Because there is another 4-letter word I hear often in our prayers, and it's so something like this. It says, the prayer says, I just, Lord, want to ask. Lord, we just want to, would you do this? And just do this. And the vocabulary begins to limit our faith. It's a 4-letter word that needs to be deleted from our prayer vocabulary because it says God has a limited thing we might squeeze out a little bit of to answer our need. And the contrary is, there's a 4-letter word. I want you to replace that which you have deleted in your prayer vocabulary, and it's this. Are you listening? This is important. Bold. And here's my text from Ephesians chapter 3. I'm going to take a few verses. It says, God's intent was that now the church would have the manifold wisdom of God, that the rulers and authorities in heavenly realms would be involved according to his eternal purpose, which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord, in him and through faith in him, that we may approach God with boldness and confidence. It is the teaching of the Bible on prayer that is most appropriate to what we do. And it is God's teaching to us that our prayer should be full of faith and expectation, and we're not trying to limit him. Our faith is not limited. Rather, our faith is full of boldness as we approach this great array of spiritual resources in heavenly realm and bring it to earth. Now, let's look at our prayer list. We're going to pray boldly for these needs, and the ones that I've got have come from places across America, here locally in our area, one from New Mexico and Texas and Ashtabula, Ohio. What is important is not from where they come, but the heart cry of these people. And you have ones similar to these, one for a man out of work for 7 years. And a mom praying for a son who has strayed. And as is often a man for good health for his wife, healing in her body. And my list has another son, salvation for that son. Here's a heart cry to be infused with the Holy Spirit of God. And another one, again, I need a job. You can continue in, as we're in this few moments together in prayer, but would you focus with me? Maybe lift these to heaven as we pray together. Oh, thank you, Lord. There is no limit to your power. There is no shortage of your capacity to answer prayer. And therefore, we come boldly to your throne that dispenses grace and healing and power. And we approach that powerful throne and ask, oh God, that you would indeed hear these requests and answer these cries. Those who are asking for healing in their bodies, those who are asking for employment, they need a job simply to create income in the family. Those who are troubled with family relationships, parents over children, and children who are caring for parents. And we lift these, Lord, to you because we know that you answer our prayers. You hear our prayers, you answer prayers. And we boldly ask, oh God, that you would now bring answers to each of these that have been called in across this room. And those who are watching on the internet, that you would indeed, they would indeed receive answers to their prayers. Do miracles, we pray, in this supernatural realm is our ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Today on the 700 Club, Rich Wilkerson told the story of what happened when his child died. And you can watch the program and find the rest of the story. But I liked what he said when he, pertinent to what we're just doing, his uncle would come and visit and they would pray, or they would hear him, excuse me, they would hear him, Rich would hear his uncle praying, asking for New York City, asking for him to be used in reaching New York City for Jesus. His uncle's name was the legendary, the late David Wilkerson. So many of us have been touched by his work, by his book, by his ministry called Teen Challenge. And out of that experience, our guest, Rich Wilkerson, developed a passion for praying for his city in Miami. It's a lesson we need to hear, praying for our city, praying for our world, praying boldly for God to answer our prayers. He's on the 700 Club today. He's here in our 7 Days Ablaze Chapel. Would you welcome from Miami, Florida, Rich Wilkerson.
Thank you, Dr. Little. What a great honor to be with you today, men and women. And if anybody is going to heaven, it's people that go to church at lunchtime. Wow. I said, there won't be a, you'll be able to shoot a gun through there and not hit a soul. This is amazing. Bless your hearts. It is indeed an honor for me to be with you today. First time I met Pat Robertson was 42 years ago. I was 20 years old. In Dallas, Texas, when 700 Club had Channel 39 over there, and I'd go over and be with him. What a man of God. And then Dr. Little and Dr. Steve Lentz, who's here this morning, lifelong friend, and Pastor Joel Paulzer. We've known each other for the same amount of time, too, Joel. And, okay, anyway, no, we've been friends for so long. Great, great friend. And my dear sister, Lori Stewart, is on staff here, so this is a huge day for me. Joel did say to turn your cell phones off, but this, my notes are on my cell phone. I just this one time. Okay, good. When I was 12 years old, I went the first time to see my cousin. You know, I'm always asked, are you related to David Wilkerson? And then my son, my second son, has become quite well known, Rich Jr. And now I get asked wherever I go, are you Rich Jr.'s dad? And now here at 700 Club, are you Lori's brother? So, I mean, I'm just glad to be anywhere, okay? But when I was 12, I went for the first time with my father. And this afternoon, Lori and I will fly to Fresno for Daddy's funeral. He passed away this past week. And we have the first of two funerals in Fresno and the next Friday night in Miami. What a great man. But Dad took me with him to New York the first time when I was 12 years of age to visit David. And for 2 weeks, we worked with him there on the streets. And then every summer, I would go for 2 weeks. And back then, the New York City police would help my cousin set up staging at the Fox Street in the Bronx. And one square block was 10,000 people. And in the evening, about 9 o'clock, he would start the crusade meeting. There'd be some songs. He'd preach for about 20 minutes. And people 25 and 30 stories up in the air would hang out of their windows listening to him. The street was jam-packed already. And then after about 20 minutes of message, David would give an altar call. And the altar call would take about 40 minutes. That's why he wouldn't preach so long, because, you see, back then, they could only come to Christ by coming down the fire escapes on the outside of the building. Never did any of the elevators work in those old tenement houses. And David would wait and wait. We'll wait longer, and they'd sing it again. We must have sung Amazing Grace 5,000 times through the years, waiting for people to get to the altar. And finally, they would come, and they would pray. I was 14 years of age, and one night before the service, we'd been working these tenement houses all day. Just the smell of urine just kind of stays in your brain for a week. Just open cesspools and what people lived in at that time, just a squalor. And we would go in and out of heroin shooting galleries. I was 14 years of age. That particular night, we were going up the stairs, a staircase. It was very dimly lit, maybe a light about 20 stories up. And as I turned the corner, I was with two teen challenge workers. They said, we're going on a mission. I thought we'd been on a mission the whole day. You know, I'm wiped out. I'm 14. I'm turning the staircase, and I felt something wet on my neck. And I looked up, and I saw a little three-year-old kid peeing through the banister railing onto me. And I was 14, you know, and I said to these guys, man, dang, the kid just peed on me. And the one teen challenge worker said, Rich, if people get saved tonight, it won't even matter. I said, man, did that kid pee on you? You know, it mattered to me. And about 2 minutes later, we were knocking on the door of this tenement house apartment. And you got the smell. The door opened, and there was these two blonde bombs inside. And this is before Yankee Candles, but they had, I don't know if it was Glade Mystery Freshener, I don't know, but it smelled really good. I wanted to get in there. So they said, well, come on in. And so we walked in. Now, we're in the Bronx, and they're doing, come on in. And so we went in. The three of us went in. We sat down, and they told us their story of Brother Dave coming to the University of Arkansas a year and a half earlier when they were still juniors at that university, preaching the gospel. And the two of them that were atheists had accepted Christ as their Savior. And they said, after being filled with the Spirit, you know, when we graduate, we'll spend the first 2 years of our life at Teen Challenge in Brooklyn. And when I got done hearing their story at the age of 14, I walked out of that tenement house that night down to the street for the meeting. And I remember as a 14-year-old boy saying, devil, you peed on me tonight. You thought that would take me out. That was the one thing I needed to seal my call for Jesus Christ. You know, in Philippians chapter 2, many of you are very familiar with this passage of scripture. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. I want to just read it. I don't want to belabor the point, but I want to give you a foundation for the few moments I want to share with you today from Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. The apostle writes these words, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. The Bible says that From this point on, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. My wife is right now working on her doctorate of ministry degree, and this last class, she flies every quarter to this location and sits with a doctoral cohort. And this last course, she heard the traveling woman professor give her testimony before the week started. And she said, you know, in 1998, this university that I teach at made me the dean of students. And I was the first woman to ever hold such a high position in the university. And I was having a great time. I thought I was doing a fantastic job. The entire administrative team was male. I was the only woman. I just thought I was doing great. But about 5 years later, they called me in, the administrative team of which I was a part, but it was a special meeting about me. And they said, you know, it's just not working out. Now, she said, I'd never been written up in 5 years. All they did was applaud anything I did. The school had grown. But they said, it just isn't working out. And so you have one of two options. You can, you know, be knocked back to your original position as a professor, or you can take an early retirement and your severance will be incredible. And so she said, I was pretty brokenhearted, and I accepted being knocked back to my original position as professor. And I've been there ever since. And she said, you know, I began battling bitterness. And I had all kinds of reasons as to why they knocked me back. And she said, I was praying one day after about 3 or 4 months, and I was getting bitter. And she said, that's just not me. And she said, I was praying, pouring out my heart to God. And I said, God, I don't know what to do. I just don't know what to do. I just can't go any higher, God. I don't know what to do. And she said, I heard this voice from the Lord say, you know, you could always go lower. And when I heard that story, it resonated with me. When we talk about going lower, we are talking about going into people's worlds to serve them when it's not easy to serve them. And that's what I want to talk about today, that thought. You could go lower. When you're worried that you are at the top of the heap and there's nowhere else to go, and where do I turn to? Hey, you know what? God says today, you could always go lower. You see, I see Jesus in heaven, and I see if it's possible, and I know this is probably more Arminian than it is Calvinistic, but I almost see God wringing his hands somewhat. You see, thousands of years of turtle doves and bulls and lambs being slain, it just has not worked. And the mess on earth is so prevalent that God has not spoken to mankind for 400 years. There's been silence in heaven. And the silence is a result of the brokenness in heaven, the broken heart of God. And when John sees heaven in Revelation, he does his best to try and relate what heaven was like in 2,000 years ago in his economy. So he shows us golden streets and you know, jeweled gates and all of that. And I'm sure, but in our day and age, we would have to see heaven as a million square feet of Bill Gates' house. Virtual everything, instant, anything you need. I mean, you can just see angels. Here's your hamburger. I mean, any thought that you would have, boom, right now. And I feel as though there's somewhat of a picture towards the end of the 400 years where the broken heart of God is just, it has silenced him. And I see the King of Kings lean into his father's ear and say, "You know, Dad, I could go lower. I could go to them. I could leave this, and I could go into their mess." I'm talking about a mess. I'm talking about a mess where the salt has been removed for 400 years. I'm talking about the Roman Empire, which is debauched. Not long after the time of Christ, you have Caligula. You have, here he is, floating nude on the lake in a marbled ship, naked with his boyfriends and girlfriends, doing it in front of his constituents on the shore as they applaud. I'm talking Nehru, who watched Rome burn and thought it was fun. I'm talking about a debauched society where Jesus says, I could go lower. And men and women, today, I believe that he is calling us to go lower into their brokenness. Into their brokenness. Alan Hirsch has written a book called The Forgotten Ways. And in this book, he talks about apostolic genius. And Dr. Hirsch says that apostolic genius has to do with unusual Jesus movements that have occurred throughout the centuries, not the least of which was the first one after Jesus ascended to the right hand of God the Father. And from that time until the year, 300, when Constantine made the Christian faith a rule, the church had grown from zero to 20 million people worldwide. How did that happen? No Bible. No buildings. No television. No internet. And it's illegal. And you can die if you join them. We talk so much about doctrine. Theology. The early church had one doctrine: Jesus is Lord. And for that, I will die. That is all I need. Caesar is not Lord. Jesus is Lord. And I'll go to the chopping block, whatever it takes. I will be his servant. I will go lower for my Jesus. We talk so much about leadership. It's leadership, leadership, leadership. I'm working on a degree right now in leadership. Jesus didn't speak of leadership. He spoke of followership. How good of a follower are we to follow him into the deepest of depths? Another apostolic genius occurrence was, of course, during the Chinese Cultural Revolution. In 1950, when Mao Zedong took his position as the head of China, there were about 2 million people who were believers in China at that time, out of 540 million. Over the next 26 years, until he died in 1976, he was responsible for the slaughter of some 70 million of his fellow Chinese people. It was his desire to eradicate all faith, all religion of any kind. He went after pastors, leaders, apostles, prophets. Right away, they were taken out. It was a slaughter of faith. 26 years later, when he passed away, and it was about 4 years from then that China began allowing the West in for surveys and research, about 1982, the American Christian world and the Western Christian world began coming out of China with these statistics. That now, 26 years later, after the slaughter, there were now 67 million Christians in the underground church. No Bible. No pastors. no buildings, and it's illegal. You could get killed if you join them. And what the response of the early church and the Chinese church was, what time is the meeting? Can we bring friends? Yeah, but the authorities will be there. Trouble lurks. Good. We'll be there early for prayer. And that if anyone wants to talk, that'll be fine. What is the message tonight? Well, we have no Bible. So it's the same message we've always preached. Jesus is Lord. Okay, that's good. That's all we need. I'll be there. Should I bring my burial clothes? I'm ready. Today, there are over 100 million in the underground Chinese church with 1.2 billion in that country. Some years ago, two writers who were not very well known became well known almost overnight. Frenchmen who wrote a book called Blue Ocean Strategy. It was a kind of a monumental book, and it was kind of a game changer for Wall Street at the time, because they talked about the Blue Ocean Strategy in business terms. And they said that 40% of the business world was caught up in the red oceans. The red ocean is where historical, it's a little early on that screen, but that's cool. Keep it up now. The red ocean is where typical business is done. Dog eat dog, old ideas. The ideas that are new are old ideas with new names. There's headhunters where you go in and steal a CEO from one successful company to try to put him or her on top of your failing company. And it's just it's a world infested with sharks. That's why they call it a red ocean. The blue ocean for business is the 1040 window, where there's millions and billions of people. They don't have a lot of money, but they have some money, and they can buy stuff. The Arab Spring started with smartphones. What are we doing in the blue ocean? And I read that, and I heard about it, and I thought, well, what about the church world? It's kind of the same deal. We spend about 40% of our time as a Christian church in the red ocean. We set up churches next to churches, hoping they'll leave that church to come to our church. We are in love with suburbs in America. The Bible Belt, that's our favorite place. But when you get into areas where atheism and agnosticism and multicultural places are on fire for whatever they believe, that sometimes is where the church has the greatest fear. But I'm telling you, friends, that's where the gold is in God's economy. When we begin to move into God's blue ocean world, I'm telling you, the miracles that are possibly there, that are potentially there, that actually are there, are beyond belief. You say, how do you say that, Rich? Romans 5:20 says, where sin did abound, there did grace much more abound. So wherever the greatest sin is, the greatest grace is. That's where God's gold mines are. His oil reserves, his diamond mines are wherever the greatest sin is. The greatest impossibilities are the places where God's gold is. I'll never forget we moved to Miami 16 years ago. We had about 250 Haitian people, and it was just a different whole deal. And our Sunday night services, you literally, and I'm not exaggerating this, okay, I'm 62 now, I had all those days to do that. We heard gunfire on a fairly regular basis during church. I mean, that's where we live. And the Haitian gangs, according to the Miami Herald, are the scariest gangs because there's not a leader. They operate by committee. So when they get into the car at night, they load their chambers, and when they open fire, they all empty their chambers because they're all going to jail for the same thing. They're all going to death row for the same thing. It's not going to be one guy that goes down. We'll all go down. That's a definite. If you're in that business, that's a game changer. So that's who we're dealing with. And it's in that arena where we have seen the power of God break strongholds of voodoo and satanic activity like you cannot believe. So when we were miraculously able to get a new facility, because we couldn't fit in the tent anymore, because we had outgrown our building, so we set up a tent. We finally outgrew the tent after three services. A miracle building came available and financing. And after I got in, I heard that Tootsie's had bought the big building right behind us. I was so ticked. You know how sometimes you've thought cuss words, but you don't say them out loud? I got to tell you something. I'm on the road to sanctification. I'm not totally. I was so ticked off. I had words going through my head. I was pleading the blood, God, don't let that come. I was mad. I was mad at our mayor. You see, Tootsie's is the largest nude bar in the state of Florida. 88,000 square feet of nudity, I'm told. And I asked her why she did this. She said, we needed the revenue. I said, the loss of family values, the breakup of family, the theft of dad's weekly paycheck will cost this community so much money that the little pittance that comes in from this nude bar, and she came to me 5 years later and she said, you were right. I had to go to Trinity Church every day, our building where we have our meetings, and I had to pull into Tootsie's to go to Trinity. Or I'd go up to the stoplight and wait a month and take a left and go down and wait till March and take another left. Or you could take a shortcut. You pull into Tootsie's, a hard right onto the service road, all the way around to Trinity. So every morning I would pull in and I'd roll my window down every morning for 3 years. You know, I'd stick my hand out the window. In the mighty name of Jesus, I come against that foul, lustful. Oh yeah, you know the drill. I would kind of get up for the day doing that. And I'd get to the office. I'd be all up. You cursed Tootsie's again, right? You rebuked him, hellfire. I said, oh, you know, I did. They went, all right, okay, good, praise God. Oh yeah. 3 years. And going home, had to do the same thing. Passengers, in the mighty name of Jesus. My God, whatever goes, you know, I did that whole thing. 3 years, morning and night. I started my day, ended the day. One day I was going through and I started the drill. And I felt this presence and I felt the voice of the Lord say, you really don't love those people, do you? And I put the brakes on. And I just went, I come against you, devil, in the name of... Okay, so I put it back in driver's, and I heard the voice again. You don't love these people, do you? I said, Lord, is that you? And I pulled over into the dirt because I knew it was the Lord speaking to me. I said, I can't believe what you're saying. I can't believe it. And I heard this line, Rich, before you were you, you were them. And I loved you then. I'm expecting you to love them now. And I broke and I wept and I repented for my religion and my judgment and my legalism. I asked God to crush it. And I got to the church that day, and I went in, and I was very sorrowful and very broken. And the staff said, Pastor, did you come all the way to the light? Did you not get to go into Tootsie's at all? And I said, no, I went to Tootsie's. It was really bad today. We don't love them. All we want to do is curse them. And they went, what? And we went upstairs together and we had a prayer meeting for Tootsies. And the next weekend was our annual prayer conference at the church. And on Saturday, we had about 500 people join for prayer from 8 o'clock till noon. And our people, you know, I know there's different ways of praying, and I'm into all of them, you know. And I'm into the whole, you know, whatever, however you want to pray. But our people yell. I don't know why our people just don't believe God hears unless you're yelling in your language, okay? And so it's, I mean, let's just ask God to help. Oh, my God! Oh! And they can go for hours that way, okay? I don't care how you pray. I'm just telling you how our people pray. And so for a couple hours, we've been about 500 just going all over the sanctuary, rebuking the devil, pleading the blood of Jesus. And the Spirit of God spoke to me and said, stop the people from praying and tell them we're going to take a march around Tootsies. I stopped the prayer and I said, the Lord just said we're not supposed to pray right now. We're going to march around Tootsies. Wow. Now, folks, our folks aren't great at everything. But marching is what we do. Okay? We can march. I'll tell you right now. All right? And when I said we're going to march around Tootsies, oh, my God. Oh, you have no idea. People went into tongues. It went just crazy. All right. Finally. What took you so long, Pastor? You know. So I said, now, here are the rules. The Lord gave me the rules. No cursing. You know, when we say cursing, I curse that, you know, that kind of stuff. So, no cursing. No rebuking. No get. Don't use the blood. Don't get the blood going. Don't start that. No tongues. No singing. No singing. We're gonna walk out of here in twos down Northwest 2nd Ave for two blocks on the sidewalks, public property. Take a ride at Miami Gardens, two blocks. Get past the parking lot of Tootsies. Take a right down their parking lot on sidewalk. And then we're going to kneel and we're going to reach toward. And as we pass Tootsies in our preparation to kneel, when you see him, you just, bless you. Bless Trinity Church. Bless Tootsies. Love. Blessing and love. Love you. Blessing. Bless. People are going, okay. Okay. So we headed out. Now, folks, if you put 500 people in twos in single file over two blocks, that looks like 10,000 people. Okay. So people on 441, which is this giant thoroughfare with no side pullover at all, were parking their cars, rolling their window down. What are y'all marching for? And our people were here, Trinity Church, we're going to go around and bless Tootsies. People put their car in park, get out, close the door. I'm in. I promise. We picked up a couple hundred people who parked their cars illegally on 441 to join the march. We marched, we blessed them, they were shocked. We marched back, we blessed them on the way back. 2 weeks later, we're finishing our noon prayer meeting on Wednesday. We had about seven, now we have a couple hundred every Wednesday, our noon prayer meetings. And Mark Batterson's gonna be here this week, and we do Circle Maker prayer meetings every Wednesday, a couple hundred people, and we yell. Anyway, so we were finishing up the prayer meetings about 1 o'clock from noon to one. They were leaving, and I was exiting. I was the last one out. And there was a little girl at the back door, and she was holding a brand new baby child, baby boy. And she was standing there just sobbing, holding this baby boy. And on a scale of 1 to 10 in beauty, she would be about a 12. I wanted as closely as I could see. About a 12. I said, honey, can I help you, sweetheart? No, I can't. No, it's bad. It's really bad. I said, well, what is it? I can't say. It's so bad. I can't say. I said, well, what is it? I said, I'm the pastor of the church. You can tell me. No, you're not. No, you're the young man last night. He's the pastor. Well, the night before is Tuesday night. We have our rendezvous meeting every Tuesday night. My son leads that. About 1,200 young adults in their 20s and early 30s are a part of that meeting. It's like no other meeting I've been a part of. She said, my girlfriend's... I said, well, that's my son. I'm the old pastor. She went, oh, okay, okay. She said, my girlfriends have been inviting me for a long time to the rendezvous. And I finally came last night. She said, you got to realize, I've never, ever in my life one time been in a church building, ever. And she said, I can't explain it. But she said, at the end, when he asked people to come forward and that God would forgive them if they would admit their sin, it was like a magnet pulling me down. I couldn't help it. I went down, and I broke, and I wept, and he told me that I accepted Jesus. And she said, I've never had that feeling in my life. And folks, people need to feel God. You can give them all kinds of logic and stuff up. They need to. Eventually, I got to feel them. 90% of the people who left the church last year said they left because they never experienced God at their church. And she said, I've never had that feeling. I was free. But she said, then I got home and everything is bad. I said, what happened? I can't say. I said, you've got to tell me. I promise. She said, for the past 3 years, I've been the lead dancer at Tootsie's. I love it. I hate men. I love taking their money. I hate men. But when I got home last night, free and happy and joyful, I held my little man in my arms. And I remembered what I did and why I was doing it. And then I had conflict because I realized that I don't really hate men. I don't hate him. And if I don't hate one, I can love them all. I'm in a bad place. I can't go back, Pastor. I can't go back there. I put my arms around her. And her little boy separates. I held her. I said, honey, we've been waiting for you. We've been praying for you. We have been waiting for someone to start the parade from Tootsie's to Trinity. You're it. I took her upstairs to my little daughter-in-law, Dawn Cherie, and they became fast friends, and she joined Dawn Cherie's Connect group, and she brought a bunch of girls to Jesus. And then she started a company cleaning houses, and she had a bunch of girls help her cleaning houses, and it became very profitable. And she and her mom took all of the young ladies that were now cleaning houses and making good money, and they moved to Atlanta. That's where all the people in Miami that turn around, they all moved to Georgia. I don't know. But I'm just telling you, change by the power of God. I've had this lesson in my heart for a long time. It's better to love the hell out of people than it is to try to preach the hell out of people. I believe that loving is the Jesus way. It may not be the religious way. It may not be the correct doctrinal way. But indeed, it is the Jesus way. Today, the young Chinese believers, if you'll put that global picture up, gentlemen, have decided to take a trip from Shanghai to Jerusalem. Some of you have heard about it. There are 100,000 young adults signed up for this journey. They are going to take the Bible back to the city where it all originated. If you'll put the next screen up, this is the journey. 100,000 young Chinese adults are being trained to walk almost 5,000 miles through Buddhist, Hindu, Muslim territories, sharing their faith, planting churches from Shanghai to Jerusalem. It's called a Blue Ocean March. They know they will be slaughtered along the way. They are training these young people how to jump off 100-foot-tall buildings without breaking their bones. They know they will be killed along the way. Recently, 38 of them left for Jerusalem. Only two got out of China. What do you think the underground church in China is doing? Yes, two got out. Now they just have to go through Islam and Buddhism and Hinduism, but we're on our way. Somebody has to go into the blue oceans of this world to redeem people for Jesus Christ. That's why I say today, men and women, when you're wondering whether or not you can go any higher, I really believe with all my heart, you can always go lower. I want you to bow your head with me as we bring this session to an end. I wonder how many would just say, Pastor Rich, you know, I've never really considered servant leadership like it was presented today. I've kind of been on a journey, upwardly mobile staircase into victory. Today, I realize that maybe if I'll go lower, I'll reach my highest heights. When Jesus came to this dirt ball, when it was all said and done, the Bible says, consequently, God has given him a name which is above every name. Today, I wonder how many, I'm not going to ask you to stand or come to the front, but you'd say, Rich, I just need prayer on this journey. I want you to include me in prayer, your final prayer. I'm on a journey right now. I just need prayer today for the journey I'm on. If that's you, just raise your hand right now quickly. All over this auditorium, raise your hand. Oh, man, praise God. I want to believe God with you, right? Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for every man and woman who sits here at lunchtime during this 7 days of power, blasting, amazement, intercessory prayer. I ask God that in this moment, your nail-scarred hand would touch the raised hand of each of my brothers and sisters. May they know that you are there, that when they are willing to go lower, in time they will reach their highest heights. Because of your grace, which knows no limit, bless my friends and bless this ministry, God. May we know that the best truly is yet to come. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Rich. We pray God's blessing on you. And we'll see you all tomorrow at 12 noon. God bless you.